From Florida. Good afternoon in Europe, elsewhere around the world. I'm Jim Lane. Welcome to our Digest webinar series. Our focus today is the Port of Rotterdam, opportunities for renewable chemicals and fuels. Thanks for joining us, all of you, today. Among the 50 hottest companies in the advanced bioeconomy that we track quite a bit, a number are already active in the port, including Nouryon, Enerkem, BP, Neste, Shell, a lot of big players, also Alco Energy, Air Liquide, and many others. They're doing projects including marine biofuels, green bunker fuels, renewable diesel, hydrogen, ethanol, biodiesel. It's a big story. Stijn Efting, the business manager for the chemical and bio-based industry at the port, has agreed to join us today. We're glad to have him for this presentation, and also he'll join us for the Q&A and discussion. Later in the hour, we will be taking your comments and questions. You just type those in the white box at the lower left of your screen. You're going to see a scroll of commentary on your left. That's people like you. They are exchanging ideas and debating on what they're hearing, meeting up and asking questions, of course, of our team from the port. So join in. It's good for everyone to connect and reconnect and to get answers to questions, especially in these virtual times. If you're a first-time visitor, do type a hello. Tell us what you're up to and who you are. We'd like to hear from you. The Digest webinar is being recorded this afternoon. You will receive a URL to access the recorded version for your on-demand review. And for those of you that like to read the slides, we will be sharing the slides later this week in the Digest. And with that, I'd like to now turn us over to Stijn. Thanks for joining us and for this Digest webinar, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Jim. Thank you very much for the and thank you very much for also for the opportunity to tell a little bit about Port of Rotterdam, about who we are, what we do on your through your platform and your website. It's a great honor for us and for me personally to have this opportunity to address you all. A short introduction about myself. My name is Stijn Efting. I'm responsible for Port of Rotterdam's renewable chemicals and fuels program. And today we will provide an introduction, and we'll take you all on a virtual tour through Port of Rotterdam, focusing on the industrial cluster we have here, and also focusing on our ambition and efforts to reduce the CO2 emissions of that industrial cluster. But most and for all, we also would like to have the opportunity here to show to all of you how we can help you around the world to realize your ambitions in the renewable industry here in Rotterdam. But we try and make it a little bit interactive, this presentation. So we will have some polls in between. So we will start with the first poll question, also for us to have a little bit of a feeling of who's on the line. So Jim, if you could put up the first poll question, especially for you to answer which part of the world you are joining us, also that I can understand if I have to address you the good morning, a good afternoon, or a good evening. And this is not a test. I'm sorry. There won't be any certificates at the end of this at the end of the call, but I see a lot of answers coming in. Very nice. So I would say balanced score with but also people from Asia, even Africa, the Middle East. So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to you all. Thank you very much. The next poll question is also what it is you are already knowing of Port of Rotterdam, but also to get a little bit of a feeling for what you are interested. That will be the next question on the port. Good. I see a lot of answers already coming in. It's the largest European port. Yes, that's obvious. Something that a lot of people know, which is an obvious factor. And the second part, with 25% of the score, roughly speaking, is that indeed there is a very large integrated petrochemical and refining cluster. And surprisingly, not unsurprisingly, that has a lot of CO2 emissions. So thank you all for submitting it. You have at least a good understanding of what we are, what we do, and I hope after this presentation, an even better view. And then the final question before we get into the presentation itself is to understand a little bit what you are most interested in during our presentation, so I can focus my story around your answer. Massive. Oh, about a third between the strategy, the projects, and the opportunities. Good. Interesting to see that I'm not expecting a lot of Q&As based on this poll, but let's see. Thank you very much. But I think all three subjects that have the majority of the votes, so the strategy, our projects, but also the opportunities, will get plenty of attention. Thank you very much for joining in on this poll. It makes our job a lot easier. You all passed for this exam. Now let's get into the story. I'm waiting for the slide to load here. Port of Rotterdam is indeed the largest European port. It's located in the Netherlands, at the border of a river estuary system in the North Sea, and it has excellent connections to the European hinterland. You can get by a barge, rail, and road all the way into Europe, into a hinterland of more than 300 million consumers. And because of our geographical advantage, Port of Rotterdam became what it is today, and it is basically a very large port and industrial cluster. It takes about an hour drive to cover all the port and industrial area, and it is basically a massive, massive petrochemical and energy hub. Crude oil refineries, companies like Shell, BP, ExxonMobil are here, but also in the renewable domain there are companies here. Neste has a very big renewable diesel facility here. Alco Energy was just mentioned with a corn ethanol facility, but also there's a lot of vegetable oil production and refining going on. Now I'll be flinging some numbers towards you just to paint the picture and also to introduce the challenge. On an annual basis, about 465 million tons of cargo is being transshipped to Port of Rotterdam. About 100 million tons of that is crude oil. Crude oil that is processed, amongst others, in the 5 local petrochemical refineries. So it is a massive, massive energy hub. About 8,800 petajoules of energy is being transshipped through Rotterdam into Europe annually. And to put that into perspective, it's about 3 times the energy consumption of the Netherlands. And about 13% of the total European energy demand. And letting that sink around the world, try and visualize how big such an industrial cluster is, but also try and think of the importance and the way to our local, regional, our port is. There exactly is also where the challenge lies, because that massive industrial cluster also is a large CO2 emitter. It emits about 30 million tons of CO2 each year, and that's about 16% of the total emissions in the Netherlands. Then something about us as an organization, so the Port of Rotterdam organization. We are a port developer, an infrastructure developer, and I want to spend a little bit of attention to you, customers, and stakeholders to achieve for future generations. Again, going back to the picture I just painted and will paint in a few slides to come, and think this over. The energy transition and battling climate change is really at the core of our organization and at the heart of our strategy. We sincerely believe that the only way to make this mission happen, to provide future generations with a source of well-being and a source of income and a place to go to work, a place to thrive in our port and industrial cluster, we need to drive CO2 emissions down. And a picture says more than 1,000 words, because when we were preparing this presentation, we were thinking about what it is actually that defines us, what are we good in as an organization? And that's basically, we are good at big scale, large scale, multi-stakeholder and complex projects. And the case in point I'm trying to illustrate here is the picture you see. And it doesn't only just show the tip of the industrial base we have here, but it shows Maasvlakte 2. It's our latest port expansion project. It's 2,000 hectares of land reclamation. Gotten from the North Sea, land reclaimed from the North Sea in a marine reserve. The North Sea is one of the harshest environments in the world. It's a €3 billion expansion project. And we have managed to complete this project with multi-stakeholders on time and within budget. So that's very good. So summarizing, good multi-stakeholder, complex projects that have more than a technical aspect to it. A second picture that also shows more than 1,000 words is at the heart of our industrial cluster. This is in the center of the port area, and it's meant to give you not only wording and not only schematics, but a overview of the challenge we see for the future. This is only a part of the industrial cluster. There's two world-scale refineries, only multiplied by 3, and you know what asset base we have here, and you know what the value is between future generations, and you can also understand why the energy transition is so important to us, because we sincerely believe that without the energy transition, there is no sustainable source of well-being and income for future generations to come. Now, to our vision. We sincerely believe that we need to go to a port and industrial cluster that is CO2 neutral in 2050. The Paris Treaty alignment goals, but again, it's because we believe it's the only way to make sure that there's sustainable economic growth for futures to come. And now the question is, how do we get from where we are today, this big, massive fossil energy-based industrial cluster, over 30 years' time towards a CO2 neutral and circular industrial port. And we know this will be a big challenge. We know this will take a lot of steps and a lot of complex investment and a lot of risk taking by a lot of parties to come over a long period of time. But the message I want to put out here to all of you that are listening is we are up for that challenge. We are up and we are good at multi-stakeholder, complicated, large-scale projects that make this happen. Now a little bit about our strategy. We have come up with a 2050, which is a long period of time, on how to do that. And this is not, of course, a strategy that has been dreamed up overnight. We've taken our time. We've done a thorough two-year investigation back in 2015 and 16, together with the German Wuppertal. Analysis. We have come up with our three-step strategy towards a carbon neutral port in 2050. And let's go over them Now, shortly and a bit more in detail in a few slides to come. So the first step is to invest in efficiency, increasing basically the performance of the existing asset base, and investing in infrastructure to make sure that you are ready for the future energy system. Invest in new sources of energy production, clean sources of energy production, but also alternative uses of energy production. And the third is setting up a new system for raw materials and fuels. It's basically circular economy. Reusing waste materials, making use of bio-based feedstocks and alternative materials. And these are not steps that wait for each other. Already started to get not to get with war. And again, as I'm starting to sound like a broken record, but also to make sure that this stays an industrial cluster of important, that it stays a source of economic well-being for generations to come. Now, how does then the carbon neutral port of the future look like? And it's basically, you can divide it into five areas: heat, electricity, circular, hydrogen, and CO2. And in step one, increasing the efficiency and building the infrastructure, we are going to do investment projects that make better use of the energy that is already in the port. So it's about making sure there is a grid for the exchange of residual heat. It's making sure that there is a steam grid that companies can connect to and better make use of their existing capacity of steam boilers and not having to produce too much for themselves, but exchanging between companies. It's about realizing the infrastructure that allows for CO2 capture, CO2 storage, and eventually carbon usage, which is in the Portals project, which I will tell something later about. But those are the activities which are taking place in step one. The activities taking place in step two are about renewable electricity. It's about bringing onshore the offshore generated wind power. It's about solar power to power as a source of energy rather than natural heating purposes. And it's making the combination to hydrogen, because we feel that hydrogen is a very important, it's a very important energy source in the future. And hydrogen can be generated by utilizing the clean electricity that comes on land, that is electrolysis to take in hydrogen produced in areas in the world where you have lots of solar power, so for instance the Middle East or South Europe, through hydrogen import terminals and setting up a new supply chain. And last but certainly not least, it's the circular economy. The circular industry, which consists of through gasification projects, through pyrolysis projects, other types of circular chemical recycling projects, to make more optimum use of the renewable of the resources we have. And we feel that with these three steps, we will be able to realize our vision towards 2050 with a carbon neutral port. Good. Now we're heading into a small and intermittent break in our presentation. And we will do, before we do a short Q&A, and I will take a look at the questions in the posted in the chat in a minute. I was wondering, what if you were at the head of the Port of Rotterdam organization? What would you focus on of all of these topics? Of answers coming in. Interesting. So again, not a very distinct voting here, but the bio-based industry and waste to value seems to be quite popular, which I like. I will get into that after the Q&A a bit more, and it's something that I of course work on a lot. But I see also across the board an even spread with the focus on hydrogen, renewable energy, CO2 capture and storage and utilization, also an interesting, very interesting topic. But well, good to hear that the bio-based industry and waste value industry is certainly of interest to this group. All right, I'm going to close the poll and we're going to do a short Q&A. Let me take a look at the questions posed in the chat. I see there's a lot of questions here, and I'm sorry that I won't be able to answer all of them, but don't worry, if I don't answer your question, then we will get back to those later on. But Robert Tiemann here has a comment. As a landlord, I would accelerate the needed infrastructure for multiple parties, avoiding the state aid limitation. It's a very detailed comment, but it's an interesting one for sure, and it's also something you will find some comments on later on. Yogi Sarin asks about the status of biofuel mandate in the European Union, especially to cellulose, ethanol and renewable diesel. But the status of that is, Yogi, that the Renewable Energy Directive 2 has been passed by the European Parliament and is now up to be translated into national legislation at the member state level, which will enter into force into 2021. Cellulosic ethanol will be a mandated advanced biofuel, will qualify as a advanced biofuel under the Renewable Energy Directive 2. And for renewable diesel, it will depend on the feedstock type that you have and whether or not it's listed in a certain annex, but that's way too detailed. Then Thijs Lepelaar asks, once you get near 2050, would you refuse access for tankers to the ports which are powered by traditional bunker fuel and only allow green ships? Or is this only related to refueling opportunities in the port? Well, Thijs, thank you very much for that. 2050 is a long way out, and by that time I would hope that we don't need to forbid any use of those type of powered vessels, because they've all made the transition. What I can say is that colleagues of mine are working very hard on the transition for cleaner marine fuels. We are a very strong advocate, also part of the IMO, the international organization that regulates the fuel for ships, to drive down ships' emissions and to use cleaner fuels. All right. Thank you for these questions. Please keep on putting your questions into the chat. And again, at the end, there will be some time left to go through them and to pick out some of them. And if yours is not answered, please don't worry. Please forgive me, but we will get back to you after the session via email to answer as much of your questions as possible. So moving on. The first bit, I've talked a lot about strategy, about vision. I've painted the picture of this very large just that we are very ambitious and keen on to drive CO2 taking to do it. I will go into some of the projects as examples that we are working on. Project, not all of them are on here, but one thing I would like to stress here is that the vast majority of the projects we work on are coalitions. We work together with companies, and usually our role is a facilitating role. We bring parties together, we co-develop the project, we try and bring the project across hurdle stages of project. Again, bear in mind projects. Thing is in common for all of these projects. Yes, there are technical challenges in all of these projects, but the societal and the economic and the political challenges are often as big, if not bigger, than the technical challenges. I will talk into detail about three we are exploring if there are usable sources of geothermal heat for the production of steam and energy for the industrial processes in the port. And another one to also mention here is together with these partners that you can see on the sheet, we're working on a heat exchange network for the exchange of low-grade heat that otherwise would be cool towards domestic uses here in the region, because the west of the Netherlands, where the port of Rotterdam is a highly densely populated area. So you could utilize the heat that otherwise would be discharged into the air, but then use it for heating of people's homes. First project I would like to spend a little bit more time on, which is part of the step one, is a CO2 storage, capturing, storage and utilization project. It's a project called Portals, and colleagues of mine, together with our partners, ABN and Gasunie, are working very hard on making this project happen. This project consists of a CO2 backbone through the port, and then to which companies, CO2 emitting companies in the port can tie into, and they can discharge their captured CO2 onto that system, which then takes the CO2 and stores it 20 kilometers out at sea into depleted natural gas empty fields. Again, a multi-stakeholder project where, yes, the technical challenge plays a role, but the societal, political, and economical challenge are as big and as challenging as the technical challenge. What the current state is that the launching customers of the portals, CCS and CCU system, have filed their permit applications to be able to do their projects on site needed to capture the CO2 and bring it to the portals open access system, and to be able to apply for the incentive mechanism here in the Netherlands that is needed to bridge to make it economically viable. And the team is working very hard to make this project happen and to have it operational in 2025. This project will save about 2.5 million tons of CO2 emissions per year. So that is about 10% of the total CO2 emissions that we have today. So it's a big step in the right direction and a very important project. But also, this project makes it possible that in due course, we can utilize this CO2 as a source of carbon once processes that can process CO2 are in a position to use it at this scale and at an economically viable operation. The second set of projects, basically, that I would like to give some attention to are on hydrogen. And hydrogen is a very popular subject at the moment, and rightfully so, because hydrogen will be a very important energy carrier in the future, also because it will have, if produced from renewable electricity, virtually zero CO2 emissions. So at the moment in the North Sea, there is a lot of offshore wind being realized and constructed, and that will be coming onshore through electricity cables in our port. And this is the ideal location to set up a conversion park. And we, Port of Rotterdam, again, together with partners, are working on a conversion park from renewable electricity to hydrogen, to green hydrogen. So two examples of projects we are working on there is a project which is called H250, which is with the companies of BP and Nouryon, and Shell also is working on an electrolyzer project. And this is a 250 megawatt electrolyzer and a 200 megawatt electrolyzer, both in the works. And to put things into perspective, again, this is mega scale. The current biggest electrolyzer, hydrogen electrolyzer in the world in operation. So this is 2 to 2.5 times that. Simultaneously, together with our partner GasUnie, Port of Rotterdam is working on an open access hydrogen backbone infrastructure throughout the port, where both consumers and producers of blue and green hydrogen can tie into. And what is blue hydrogen? Blue hydrogen is hydrogen produced in a traditional way from natural gas, but it's CO2 emissions captured and stored in the North Sea using the project I just mentioned. Port of Rotterdam in this is a co-developer of infrastructure, investor, and we try to manage all the stakeholders that are involved in this field, from NGOs, from the government, from users and producers, but also we're trying to connect it to the internet and to consumers for instance, Germany or Belgium or the southeast of the Netherlands. The project in step three, which is close to my heart, which is the waste to chemicals project. And why is it close to my heart? It's a project I've been personally involved in for quite a while now. I spent a lot of time and am spending a lot of time on this beautiful project. What you see here is a picture of Enerkem's waste to chemicals facility in Canada. Enerkem is one of the five partners which we work together with on this beautiful project. Enerkem is the technology provider. They've developed a technology in Canada over the past 20 years, mind you, to produce ultimately methanol out of waste material, waste plastics, waste wood, waste cardboard, through a gasification project. And together with our partners Air Liquide, Nouryon and Shell, we are working on bringing a waste to chemicals facility to Rotterdam, which will be roughly speaking twice the size of Enerkem's existing facility. Now, this is a project that's been going on for a while, and it's not without its challenges. Again, yes, there are technical challenges. But most importantly, what we're trying to do here is we're trying to build a new supply chain. We're trying to build a supply chain bridging, let's say, the gap between what is now waste that's incinerated and discharged into our atmosphere as CO2. We'll be turning that CO2 into a valuable project, methanol, which can be used in all sorts of chemical processes, but also can be used as a biofuel. And again, that's more societal, economical challenge, and the challenge of working together with so many partners on a project. Our role here is we're a co-investor in the facility itself, bringing parties together across the value chain. and we're providing the integrated infrastructure necessary to make this project happen. We're getting to the end of my slides and my presentation here. Wrapping up, I've talked about our ambitions, about the big challenge that lies ahead of us, but also how we're up for that challenge. And if there's one thing I would like you all to remember, pick up from this conversation, is that the energy and resources transition here in Rotterdam is very, very serious to us. And we sincerely feel that this is the only way to go if we are to maintain a source of well-being for for future generations across Europe. So not only here in the region, but in Europe. And that we are always looking for partners that have similar ambitions. And we are actually looking for partners to help you realize that ambition here in Rotterdam. And we've summarized some of the opportunities we see here in Rotterdam. If you have a renewable technology you would like to bring to scale, that's in the domain of waste to fuels or in the biofuels, even power to X type of technologies, please reach out to us. Please get in touch with us. We're more than happy to see if we can develop a project together where during the next webinar, your project will be on, your name will be on one of these slides. We would love to make that happen. And as said, our role in these projects is we're really a partner. We have a big network at your disposal, networks to the governments, to NGOs, to the local industry, to the international industry. The Port of Rotterdam being a port and being a major hub in Northwest Europe, there is ample feedstock, either be it waste resources, be it biomass, be it other types of feedstocks. They're very easy to come by. We can offer finance and funding support. We can offer support in getting the right permits. And last but not least, we're working on an industrial park here in Rotterdam, which when come to fruition, allows you to focus on your core of your production units and let everything else, so the utilities, the site services, etc., handled by a third party. That wraps it up for me. I would like to thank all of you for your attention and for your questions. We will be looking at them now and answering some of those. But before I do that, I would like again to thank Jim Lane and the Biofuels Digest for offering us this opportunity to present who we are, what we do. I hope some of my passion for this topic have come across the internet, albeit that I understood that the connection sometimes was as bad, but it is being recorded, so you can listen back. But my passion, my college passion for this subject is tremendous, and we would love to do a project with you. So please get in touch. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, Stein, thank you very much for the presentation and for giving this great kickoff and overview of the port. We got a lot of questions coming in, and those of you that would like to submit a few for us to answer, we do have some time here, but we do have a lot. So we had one that I think is probably the most relevant one for right now, which is, what's the best way to start contact with the port? Should people just reach out to you in email, or do they call? Do they show up at a seminar? What's the best way to get in touch and start a project?
Send me an email and we will get back in touch with you. We set up a call and we get to work. And my email address here is at the bottom of the slide, and you will get the slides. So just send me an email and we'll get to work.
There was a question on what kinds of matchmaking activities do you have that, aside from the private ones, are there public forums that you offer, or opportunities where players who are working at the port can get together from time to time?
Yes, albeit primarily virtually in these days. So we host a series of get-togethers, which is called the Clean Mass Cafe. It's a session basically where everybody is free to attend that has an interest in the energy transition. And these sessions are usually very lively, and a lot of challenges are debated, and it's a forum where basically ideas are generated. That's one thing. Second thing is we run a startup program, which is called Port Excel, an accelerator program, which brings the existing industrial players in touch with startups that help them to see if there is a business opportunity. And the third point I would like to point out is that we do it basically for any newcomer, is that we play a liaison role, and we have dedicated people working assigned to your project that are in direct touch with the national government, the local government, but also the permitting authorities. And they basically provide you with a one-stop shop.
Had a question. To answer. Yeah, we had a question about what distinguishes the Enerkem project from there was a mention of an existing project that makes bio-based methanol. I believe that's the BioMCM and project. So yes. That's a bit up the street. Do you want to take that, Steiner, or I can clarify that if you want.
No, sure. So so BioMCN is an existing producer of biomethanol in the Netherlands. They produce biomethanol in the north of the country, but they use glycerol and biogas as feedstocks. The Enerkem process takes a solid material, so solid waste material, waste plastics, and waste-based feedstock, waste wood, those type of things as feedstock. So it's a totally different process, but exactly the same molecule at the end.
We had a question that it's probably for the project owners as opposed to the port about the cost of bulk green hydrogen. I mean, what price does it come at? I suspect that that's going to be a question for the partners to reveal, but is there any idea if there is an attempt to make competitive hydrogen, or is it more of a demonstration of the technical capability to make it?
To be honest, there I don't have that figure at the top of my mind. Of course, in first instance, the green hydrogen, I suspect, will be more expensive than fossil derived hydrogen. But I believe that that the intent is to close the gap over the life of these projects. But I'll make sure that we will follow up after this webinar with more detailed information on that question.
There was a more of a comment than a question that had to do with the position of the Dutch government regarding the development of sustainable liquid fuels, advanced fuels primarily. Is there a sense that you've mentioned that there's an acceleration program at the board? There seems to be a lot of activity. Is that a trend? Do you expect to see more types of support coming from either national or regional authorities, or is it just going to be the port?
I expect, and there's been a letter to Parliament recently where the Dutch government have explained how they look at the energy transition and what they see as their role. And I suspect that the Dutch government will become more active in supporting the transition towards more clean fuels and chemicals, towards the whole energy transition. I believe there will be much more incentivization of those type of projects, also because the Dutch government has realized that with not only the port and its industrial base, but also with Schiphol being a very large aviation hub, that that now is actually the time for change. And if anything has been learned from the current COVID crisis that we're all in, I think that they've realized that this is an excellent opportunity to become active in this place and to become a frontrunner. So I expect the Dutch government to become much more active in this field. than they already are.
We noticed that there is a some distribution now of renewable diesel in the area, because we noticed that Neste had started distributing to, I think it was like 60 or 70 different stations in the area. So it looks like not only is it a production area, but there seems to be some opportunities for distribution and offtake locally. Is that new and a growing phenomenon?
Well, we're very proud that Neste is important for Rotterdam. I believe they are one of the front runners in the industry. And yes, actually, it is kind of a trend here that you see that you see an E10 blend being available, so an ethanol 10% ethanol blend at fuel stations. Neste distributing their fuel directly to a number of fuel stations in the Netherlands and branding them under their own brand. This is only recent, but I think here in the Netherlands, but also Germany, Belgium, and I've heard similar stories about France. I think this is a trend to come. Yes.
What's the best way for people to become more aware of the infrastructure at the port, particularly the huge pipeline network that is impossible to describe in all its complexity here in a webinar? But what would be the best way for people to get in touch with what pipeline there is and where it goes? There's quite a network throughout, coming from the port throughout, connecting different places in the Netherlands. It would be good to know. What's the best place to find out about that?
Well, the obvious, but at this moment in time, unfortunately impossible answer was please come over and join us for a visit. We're more than happy to host you and show you around. But of course, the health situation needs to allow for it. And what I would do is send me an email to specify your question. We will get in touch. There are brochures on our website that detail out what pipeline connections there are for which product, with what destination and which origin. But we're more than happy to guide you through those materials, as they're quite elaborate to explain to you what is there. So we're more than happy to take that.
We did a story in the Digest about a year ago talking about the demand for green bunker fuel. And for those of us that are less familiar with marine shipping, there is renewable diesel. There's also bunker fuel, which is a much lower cost fuel. And most production has been aimed at producing renewable diesel. But we did a story on a rise in green bunker fuel demand at the port. Is that, that seems like a fairly recent phenomenon, but good news might be worth pointing to and shouting out.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. No, that's indeed true. International shipping companies, together with brand owners, have indeed fortunately woken up to the fact that their bunker fuels emit quite a bit of CO2, and they're looking for alternative options there. And just to point out and to a familiar name in the industry, the Good Fuels Shipping Company is a Dutch-based company that's working very hard on sustainable marine fuels. And indeed, they are using the renewable diesel, but they're also running a series of pilots and scaling up them to demo facility to create green bunker fuels from various lignin type sources, but also pyrolysis oil is tested as a potential green bunker fuel. So companies like Maersk, like MSC, they're starting to run pilot tests on their vessels with containers around the world.
I wanted to ask a question about going back to the Enerkem project, as you mentioned, dear to your heart, a very long project with, as you mentioned, five partners now. I wanted just to roll back a little bit of the history of it. Did it, when Enerkem first came, I suspect that there were not all five partners. I believe Shell, for one, joined a little bit later. Is that typical that it starts with one or two partners and then it kind of grows from there? Is that a typical experience? And what can you just comment on how companies like Nouryon, Air Liquide came together?
Sure. And I'll use this. Let's use this as an analogy, because not all projects are alike, but they have a lot of things in common. But this project basically came to the Netherlands back then under the auspices of Nouryon, then Akzo Nobel, who had found Enerkem as a potential producer for their methanol. They wanted to drive down the CO2 emissions associated with the production of their methanol. And then they approached us, if we could find a location for them and what we could do for them. So we became a partner. Air Liquide, this process, Enerkem's process requires quite a bit of industrial gases, oxygen, hydrogen, but they're also very interested and working hard on the energy transition. So they had an interest to join. And then later on, while we were further developing the project, we were missing a partner on the fuels supply side. And we, of course, we know Shell very well as a very local asset base here. They came and joined the project as the last partner. And so it kind of naturally evolved, I would say, from this idea that Enerkem and Nouryon had to bring their technology to the Netherlands to a big project, a big potential investment with multiple shareholders, multiple stakeholders here in Rotterdam, with all parts of the supply chain covered. And I would say it depends a little bit on the type of project, and each project is of course different, but it's not uncommon that these partnerships grow over time. For one reason or another, we tend to be involved from an early stage, maybe not always from the start, but we are one for supporting in an early stage.
Shane, did we lose you there?
Ah, there you are, Jim.
Yeah, sorry, dropped out there. I was gonna ask you a question about the use of methanol at the port. Green yes. Maritime, the Green Maritime project has been the consortium has done some engine testing, and that was a question that had come in earlier. Pond Power has been active with an engine testing program. So as long as we're looking at methanol as a, potentially as a chemical feedstock, what about its opportunities as a fuel for maritime? Is that something that's simply being studied for the future, or is that under active consideration by the kinds of partners that you're in touch with?
Absolutely. We see this as a very big opportunity, especially being here in the port. We're actually part of the Green Maritime Consortium as a humble party. There is indeed tests going on, and we are looking at ways to basically invest in the infrastructure needed to get it from tanks onshore into the tanks of the ship, so to invest in these bunkering infrastructures to allow for methanol bunkering. I do sense that it will. Nobody knows how fast this will pick up, but I do sense that it will take a while to scale. That I do genuinely see this as an opportunity for the future. Yes.
So. We had a couple of private questions coming in. One was basically on how bunker fuel is made, and the answer is it's made by a variety of processes, but usually a high temperature. otherwise through a high temperature process. So it's not made through fermentation or anything like that. So let's just roll through the questions here. We had a shout out, the ART Fuels Forum, which stands for the ART Fuels Forum, the Alternative Renewable Transport Fuels Forum, is organizing an aviation meeting, and one of our attendees wanted to give a shout out to that. So if you're looking to understand the opportunities for aviation fuels in Europe as they relate back to some of the topics that we've been talking about today, because clearly Schiphol is not that far away, and this is a great place to do projects like that. So I encourage you to go over to the artfuelsforum.eu to learn more about that. Shane, is there anything that you would like to make in the way of a wrap-up comment before we close out at the top of the hour?
Well, thank you. Again, and I will be reiterating it, and thank you for raising the aviation fuel topic. Please take away, we are very serious about the energy transition. We're passionate, we're ambitious, and we love to help you realize your ambitions here, whether it's aviation fuels, whether it's marine fuels, whether it's waste to chemicals, biotechs. Please get in touch, and we will see if we can make a project happen. Thank you very much. And again, Jim, thank you very much for hosting this webinar. It's been a first of a kind experience to us and to me personally, but I enjoyed it tremendously. And thank you again for the opportunity.
Well, great to have everyone joining us around the world to learn more about opportunities in Europe, and particularly through the Port of Rotterdam. If your companies like Neste or BP, Nouryon, we've mentioned Enerkem, Shell, Air Liquide, IKEA, already know very well the opportunities and how well they work. If you're not at those companies, do suggest that you take a look. A port is a wonderful place to launch a project, because you have all the infrastructure there. All feedstocks are either there or easy to obtain. It's also a highly integrated place with lots of partners around. So a great place to launch a project. And of course, Port of Rotterdam is a place with a huge amount of experience in doing that. So I suggest that you get in touch with our friends at the port very soon. This Digest webinar has been recorded. For those of you that would like to access the recorded version for your on-demand review, we'll have that around as a URL for you to look at later this afternoon. We will be sharing the slides later this week via the Digest. And with that, I'd like to thank all our friends at the Port of Rotterdam, and Stijn Efting has joined us as a presenter today. It's been a pleasure to have you. And we'll be back again in the future shortly for another episode tomorrow of Digest Connect. And if you'll be joining us then, and we'll, of course, look forward to seeing you all in another time, another webinar, and wishing you a great day and a safe one in the advanced bioeconomy. So long. We'll see you next time.